Thomas. I'm doing 80 on I-10. Today's episode of Los Angeles Real features Kathryn McCormick. Tunnel. Actually, it's just a bridge. I lied. Kathryn McCormick from Step Up Revolution 4 and So You Think You Can Dance. She is awesome and grounded. So cool talking about everything from what she puts in her kale shakes to what it was like to get cast in a movie that went on to make $140 million. No big deal. Check us out at losangelesreal.net. We also have a Twitter feed at LA Real Show. Our Instagram is Los Angeles Real Show. And we have a Facebook page. Check them all out. Follow, subscribe. Let us know what you think. Do whatever you want. Have a good one. We'll see you soon. Welcome to Los Angeles Real. My name is Thomas Faustine Huesking. I'm joined, as always, by the one and only Christian Monson, my co-host.
Still me.
And today, we're very excited to have Kathryn McCormick in the studio.
Ooh. Hello, looking, guys.
That's her natural color.
I'm pale.
What are you going to do? Looks great, though.
Yeah.
Well, you could look like Thomas and be super orange right now.
He's just tanning.
7 hours in the tanning booth. Just kidding, I don't do that.
Just so you know, you're cutting your chin off, by the way.
Oh, okay, good.
Yeah, look at that. See how I look out for you?
It's good to be framed up well because we've been having these, you know, framing issues and technology issues. So I'm just going to go ahead and make sure my phone's off.
Personally, I like to call it growing pains. Is your phone off?
That's the question. Hold on. Let me check.
This is great. This is all a part of it.
Yeah, this is all a part of it. I just put it on silent. I just have to find it.
Boom.
Bam. We're done.
Okay. So, Kathryn, for those of you who don't know, recently had a film. Well, I guess it's recent. Last year.
Yeah, last summer.
A film called Step Up Revolution, which I watched last night. And I didn't even know there were movies like this actually being made. It's something to see.
Thomas doesn't live in the now. He doesn't.
Exactly.
I didn't even know dance existed.
Right, I didn't even know people were dancers. That's wild.
What are you guys doing on that screen over there? What is that screen?
Anyone who's seen it has to agree that there's a lot of impressive sequences in it. So if you could just talk about coming on to that film. This was your third film?
This is my first.
Your first film.
Yeah, you know, I want to know, what was it like getting that call?
Yeah, let's take us through the whole process.
Okay, because I had never acted before in my life. Even growing up, I never did theater, anything like that. I had danced for a long time. So in dancing, especially on a show like So You Think You Can Dance, you're constantly put in a position to tell stories and portray a different character each week. So I had experience with that, but I didn't really realize that that was training me for this film. I ended up where I was in a place I had just done So You Think, and then I did a motivational speaking tour.
Cool.
And then I was off of that, and I was in a place where I was like, okay, I don't know what I'm doing, I don't know what's next, and I end up getting this audition for Step Up 4 at the time. And I remember I had something going on, so I didn't think I was going to be able to go, but part of me was okay with that. I just told my agent, I was like, it's okay, I've never acted before, like, there's no way that this would even happen, so I don't think I can go, it's not a big deal. And then she ends up calling me, and she's like, no, they really want to see you, you should go in, you can go in another day. I was like, okay. So I end up going in, I was super nervous. I met with a choreographer that I knew, her husband was an actor, so I just called him, I was like, can you please help me? Like, I don't even understand how to do this or what to do. So I ended up coming in and we went through the scenes, and then I go into the audition, so nervous, just sweating. Because it's a different thing. Like, whenever you're in a dance audition, you're with hundreds of people, and you're in a giant room, and you never go by yourself.
Was it like that scene in the film? Is that what a dance audition is typically like?
Yeah. So there's people all around, and you have at least 5 people with you at a time.
Okay.
So it's different to go in this tight, it feels like you're in a shoebox, and you're just like, oh, everyone's staring at me, and you know, you're not as used to using your voice, you know, when it comes to acting. So I remember I went in the room, and it was just me and the casting director, and I was like, oh, this isn't so bad. This isn't that intimidating. And we did the scenes, and I was like, all right, I survived. Like, that was okay. And afterwards, she was like, I really like you. She was like, okay, thank you for coming in. And I left, and I was just like, wow, okay. Wasn't too bad, but didn't expect a call back at all. I left, and a couple days later, I ended up getting a call back, and they asked me to come in with the director and some of the producers and different people to read for them. So right. I was just like, oh, okay, here we go, right, I got it. So I went back and I did another coaching and I ended up going in and I sat, and it was one of those things, like whenever I get super nervous, I'll just start rambling. So I was just, I was sunburnt and I'm just like, yeah, I got sunburnt the other day, and I'm just telling them about the most random stuff, making a fool out of myself, I thought. And so we end up doing the scenes. Then the director, Scott Spear, was like, could you cold read with me? Like, just, I know that you don't really know these scenes. Are you okay with that? And I was like, okay, sure. So I was cold reading with him. And then he was like, okay. He was like, thank you so much for coming in. Like, thank you for taking the time. I was like, thank you for taking the time. I don't know why you're thanking me. And then I ended up leaving. And I remember I called my mom and I was crying. I was like, I just made a fool out of myself. Talking about, like, my sunburn. What was I talking about? Right. And I end up leaving, and then a couple of days later, I get a call back. And they're like, we want you to come in and try to, like, test your chemistry with the other actors. We want to see you dance, which, obviously, like, we've seen you dance before, but we just want to see you dance with some of the guys and see how it works. Yeah, so I ended up coming in, and a lot of the pressure was off on this one because it was my comfort zone. So I went in, and there was a guy, Ryan Guzman, who ended up getting the part, but there were two guys that were up for it, and the other guy had broken his foot or something, so he couldn't dance, but he was on tour with someone, so they knew that he could dance really well, whereas right. Ryan had never danced before in his life. So he's in this room, and it's three of us girls, and he's in this room. We're learning our part of the duet, and he's in there already learning his. And I didn't realize that he had never danced before. So they keep saying, Ryan needs more time. Ryan needs more time. And we're like, what is going on? Who is this guy?
Right.
And we end up coming in and we realized that he had never danced before. So I was just thinking, like, man, I cannot even imagine how much pressure that feels. You know, because even dancing your whole life, you still can get in your head about learning choreography and it gets scary. So we ended up going in, and I remember I saw him, and I was just like, went up to him, and I was like, hey, I'm Kathryn, and I gave him this huge hug, and just kind of sat, and I was the last girl to go. And I remember in that audition, all the girls, you think, step up, and you're like, oh, you gotta be the sexy club girl. And right. I was just like, if that's what they want, that's not what I am. So I'm not even gonna try to be that. I'm just gonna do what I do. So everyone's like getting low and like doing like butt rolls and all this stuff. And I was just kind of like, okay. And I was the last one to go. So
So the other girls that were there were also options.
Yeah, they were options. So it was three of us there.
Did you know them from the circuit or what is it?
I had met one of them briefly, but I didn't know her very well. She was on So You Think Canada, I think. And then after her, it was another girl that I had no idea who she was.
Wow, okay.
So I remember I danced with him. I felt really good about it. They made us freestyle. They just picked a random song and they were like, can you just dance for us? So did that, and I left, and I felt really good about it.
Let me ask you this. How did he do as a non-dancer? He did really well, right? I mean, he must have.
He got a lot better over time, obviously. The biggest thing was feeling comfortable with him, because the thing about dance is, like, there's no personal space. And when you're partnering with someone, it's like you'll just meet someone for the first time, and then you're just, like, connected all yeah. over their body. So you just have to get past that. Whereas a normal guy, he's a gentleman, and he was like, okay,
He needs seven drinks to be able to get on you like that.
Like, I don't want to touch your stomach. I just met you. This is weird. Like, I don't want to have, like, your hips up onto my stomach. Like, this is really weird. So for me, I just had to look at him and be like, hey, man, it's me and you. That's it. Don't worry about it. Like, I got you. We're good. And after that, he was just kind of like, felt more connected.
Dancing and acting share that same thing, right? You have that instant intimacy yeah. and trust that, oh, that's not normal. You know?
Yeah. It also helps that a professional like yourself put him at ease and said, you know good. What, yeah. this is something that is normal and it's okay, and yeah. you kind of give him the green light, and that always helps. I mean, just in dancing, but
yeah, when you can keep yourself focused on your purpose and the other person and listening to them, that's when the story's told and it's more effective, rather than thinking of everybody outside of you. Because as soon as you get out of here, your purpose is gone. Right. But when your purpose is gone, you're extremely awkward.
Yeah.
That's just how it is. That's just how it is in life and everything, in acting and dancing. So we ended up, long story short, we ended up doing that audition, and then I got a call back. It was the final audition, so the two guys were there, and then it was four of us girls. And we ended up going into the rooms and the guys would switch out, and then each girl would go with each guy, and we did two different scenes, and then they filmed it from all different angles, and they were just kind of in there watching us. And I remember I was sitting on the floor. It was at a dance studio. I was sitting on the floor waiting to go in, and I was so nervous because I was just like, I've never done this before. Like, this is awesome, but at the same time, like, I just felt pressure to be something, you know? And then I looked at Ryan, and we were about to go in, and I was like, will you just read over the scenes with me really fast? But I was trying to play it cool. I was like, will you just read over the scenes? Like, I'm good. And then he read over them with me, and, like, I was just, like, super shaky. And then I remember going into the room, and the director looked at us, and he started telling us, like, how passionate he was about it and what it meant to him and the character that I was trying to portray and the point of the scene. And all of a sudden, like, all of those nerves dropped, and I felt this weight of purpose, and I just felt like I could connect so much, and I wasn't really nervous anymore. It was a crazy thing, and I sat down, and I just had a conversation, and for the first time, like, it felt really free.
So the director's energy changed who you were in the room at that moment because of his passion. There's something that freed you from feeling any kind of commitment to what you expected to do.
I just chose to listen, and I was like, wow, he really cares about this. I can too, if I'm not so worried about everyone else. And I sat down, and it was just silent in there. And afterwards, we left, and then I got a call a couple of days later. I was driving in the car, and I got a call, and it was Scott, and he's like, hey, Kathryn, this is Scott Spear. I just wanted to call you, and I'm sorry I have to tell you this, but I just wanted to, like, thank you for even taking the time. I know it was a lot of time. So he was trying to fool me, and then he ends up saying, like, we want you to play Emily, and I just remember my wrist went weak, and I was speechless. Because the thing for me, it was like, I was just trying to overcome the fear of auditioning, and I was like, yeah, man, like, I conquered it. I never thought I would actually get the part. That's a completely different story. And then the Adam and Jennifer, the producers, they were on three-way, and then they start yelling and screaming. And I remember afterwards, he was just like, whenever I first told you, I thought you didn't care. Like, it didn't affect you. I was like, no, I was speechless. I had no idea. And then I ended up, like, calling my mom, and we're both bawling. And I'm just like, I got the part. I don't know.
How long after moving to Los Angeles from, she's originally from Georgia?
Augusta, Georgia, yeah.
Okay.
I've been here 4.5 years now. So I moved out whenever I was 18. I had graduated high school, and I was in a place where I wanted to dance, but from my city, I knew one person who was a Rockette. But other than that, I didn't understand the professional world. I didn't know how to do it. My mom was a dancer, but she opened a studio and had us really young, so she didn't really get to pursue it. And so I remember when I was 18, it was just like a constant prayer for me. And I was just like, God, what do I do? Like, I want to dance, but is this where you need me to be? You know, and I was kind of in that space. And then it ended up where I graduated high school, and I didn't go straight to college, which was kind of looked down upon from where I'm from, because everyone was like, man, she was such a smart girl, and now she's wasting it or something. And it was like, no, it's not like I'm not going to do anything with my life. I just don't want to spend money to go to college right away when I don't know what I would go for. I'll go later. So I took time off, and I was auditioning, but I was taking, like, extra classes and teaching at my studio. Then I ended up coming out to California that summer just to take classes at a dance studio out here with my dance teacher, because she had lived here prior. So I came out, and we started talking to this choreographer that I knew, and I was just asking him, I was like, what do I do? I don't know how to do this. What do you think? Like, what's your advice? And he ended up recommending me to his agency, MSA at the time. So I had a meeting with them while I was here, and I met with them, and was just talking, and they're like, we've been looking for someone like you. We don't have anyone like you, so we would love to represent you. And I didn't realize how difficult it is to get an agent. Right, so I'm just like, yeah, this is awesome.
This is really a fairy tale story.
In when you initially met with MSA, what did you, do they just talk to you? Do they look at you dance?
They just talked to me. I brought in I had different pictures from my dancing. I had clips online that I showed them and different videos. And then they ended up signing me, but they were like, this is the thing, you need to try living out here for 3 to 4 months and see how you like it, because auditions will be like a day before. There's no way you're going to get to audition for anything when you're in Georgia. Mm. So I was like, all right. And I left and I was just like, I am not moving to LA. I was terrified. I was like, I don't know anyone. I'm not doing this. And then I ended up going home and I got an audition like 2 weeks later. It was for the remake of Fame. I was like, whoa, I could do this. I was like, this is my style. This is my age. The biggest thing was like, I don't have any money. So how am I going to get to LA to audition for this? So I end up talking to my mom about it, and she was thinking about it for a while, and my mom and dad, they were just in a place where they're like, we don't really have money to get you a plane flight for an audition, that what if you get cut in the first hour, and then you come back, and it's like, I don't know if we can really do that. A couple days passed, they ended up where they decided they wanted to help me go, so they're like, we're gonna buy you a plane flight, and you can go. So excited. I emailed my agency and I was like, I'm coming. This is my first audition. And she emails me back and she's like, oh man. She's like, Kathryn, I'm sorry, but they changed the date. So you got to change your flight because you're going to get here when it's over. Ooh. And I was like, there's no change in the flight anymore because we already bought this. Like, there's nothing that I can do. So I ended up, I talked to my mom about it and she was like, maybe it's just not supposed to happen. Like, I'm really sorry. We can't change it. It's going to be double the cost. There's no way. So I was kind of bummed, but I was like, okay, that wasn't my thing. Then a couple days later, my grandparents call me, and they're like, Kathryn, we don't know why, but we can't get this feeling out of our gut that you need to be there. So they're like, if you still want to go, we'd love to help you. And I was like, are you sure? Because that's a lot of pressure to do well.
That's awesome.
But I was like, okay. I was like, I would love to go. I ended up going. It was a two-day audition, and I made it to the last 30 dancers. And they're like, you're going to be our main dancers in the film. So you have to move out here. It'll be 3 to 4 months. And I was like, whoa. Wow.
First audition.
I was like, whoa, I've heard that before. And so I ended up packing my bags. I had like a month. I packed all of my stuff. I got on my plane and I moved to LA. I was living with a choreographer that I kind of knew, her and her husband, but didn't know well. I didn't really know anybody in the city. So I was just here, but I was like, it's okay because I'm going to have a job and I'm going to meet people and it's going to be fine. So I get here and a week or so pass and I call and I'm like, hey, this is Kathryn McCormick. I'm just calling to see what my schedule is because I don't know what's going on. And they're like, oh, Kathryn, we're sorry we didn't get to call you yet, but they cast too many dancers, so you're just going to have one day of work. You're not going to... And I was like, oh, excuse me? What? I packed my whole life to move out here, and I'm staying for one day of work. And it's really funny because I know that I wouldn't have come if I thought it was one day.
Yeah.
So it was really kind of a blessing to me because I was just like, all right. I'm supposed to be here, and maybe I'm not supposed to be around these people or in this setting. Maybe I'm supposed to find freedom in LA by myself or just learn different things. So there was this, I don't know, I just felt this weight of purpose that was like, I'm supposed to be here, and I'm not leaving until I figure out why.
Yeah, there. It's one of my favorite, I think I've talked to you about this, Thomas. One of my favorite things to do is to look back at this domino effect of the decisions that lead you to the place where you're at now, whether you're in control of the decision, whether it just happens to you, or whether you end up, you know, running into somebody who puts you on purpose.
Yeah.
And then looking back at that effect, that domino effect, I just love that metaphor and that image of one decision leading to another, to the next, and then here you are.
It's like, and when you're in it, you feel like it's chaos.
Right.
And you're just like, I don't know what I'm doing. I would cry every single day. I was like, I don't know what I'm doing with my life or where I'm going or what the point is or if I'm even good enough to do this or why am I trying so hard? You know, but when you're, I think when you're in that desperate state, like the most beautiful things happen because you're learning so much and it feels crazy, but like, you're so vulnerable. And then in that, like the relationships that you build with people are so much more real.
Yeah.
Because you don't really have a choice because you're just like, this is all I got, you know? And then all that time passes and you look back and you're like, it's crazy because you always want what you don't have. So you look back and the space that you're in now, you look back and you're like, man, that time was so good. I wish I was still there. But you're like, hold on, when you were in there, you didn't want to be there.
Right, you thought it was the worst.
But now you're here. So you're like, just think, in a year, I'm going to look back and be like, man, I wish I was still there. So it's just like choosing to be okay with everything that you feel and sit in it. As long as like your intentions are good and your desires are good and you're working really hard and like more than anything, loving it, then I think you're okay.
Yeah,
that, you're taken care of.
When you found out that it was going to be one day of work, it was the end of the world.
Yeah, it was.
But it ended up being.
So is that what happened? It ended up just being one day.
It was one day at work, and then I ended up. I didn't have a car, so I would just walk to the metro and ride the metro to the other stop, and then walk to the edge, and I would do that every single day.
Wow.
And I would take like 3 to 4 classes every day.
See, people, you can use LA public transport. It works.
Yeah. Not to say that they didn't leave me a lot, and it was hard, but. Yeah,
it's the bus did.
The bus, the bus is crazy. If you're not right on the point, I remember one time I was looking at my phone and they just passed me and I was like, "Hey, I've been here for like an hour," and then I had to wait. There's like nothing you can do.
Wow.
Yeah. So I was just kind of going back and forth. I was auditioning as much as I could, but I wasn't booking anything because it was like I was like the white girl in hip hop class. Like I had never trained in hip hop, and all LA is really, or it's not, but what I thought was hip hop. So everything that was going on was that, and I didn't really have the time to like immerse myself into it. So I was just kind of like going on these auditions, and it wasn't me, but I was trying to be that because it was right. Like I'm just trying to work. Like I don't know how to do this.
Figuring it out.
Yeah, so I'm the girl, like, I remember I auditioned for Step Up 3, like, to be a dancer.
And really?
And I'm, like, dancing, and I remember I, like, ripped my pants, and I was like, man, bombed it, and just left, and I was like, I don't know what I'm doing here. And then months passed, and I was just taking class and, you know, really loving that. But then there was also this struggle of, like, what's wrong with me? Like, I'm not working. I'm not booking anything. Like, what am I doing wrong? But not realizing that everything I was auditioning for, it wasn't my heart, you know? So I found that So You Think You Can Dance came along. I auditioned for that season 5 twice. And nobody knows that because I didn't make it past the first cut.
Whoa, wow.
I auditioned season 5 twice. I remember in LA, I went with all of my friends, and I went there, and they have you audition for the producers the first time. So I remember I went in that room, and you pick your genre, and they turn on a random piece of music, and you don't know what it's going to be, and you just have to improv. So I remember it's 1 through 5, 6 through 10, you're on this wooden floor, and they're just watching you, and they'll be like, go. And then after you come out, they could give you 2 seconds, they could give you 30 seconds, they could make you dance for 2 whole songs, but then they'll just say next when they're done with you.
Brutal.
So I remember I picked jazz, and I went on the floor, and I was just comparing myself to everybody, and I was like, who am I to, like, be in this audition in LA with some of the best dancers I've ever seen? I was like, she's prettier, or she's exactly like me, and she went first, so, sorry, he's already seen it, you know? Or
all those games that you play with your mind when you're
like
in audition.
It's like your head just completely knocks you down. Yeah, it tears you down, and so I went on the floor, and I don't know what happened, but it was terrible. I just ended up leaving, and I was so disappointed. And not the
this
fact
is season
that
five.
This is season 5. Not the fact that I didn't get it, because I was used to that, like not booking things. But it was the fact that I knew I had more, and I didn't show it because I was so afraid that that wasn't going to be enough. And so that really frustrated me. I ended up leaving, and I was just kind of like, "It's okay. Like, I learned that, and next time I audition for something, hopefully I won't do that again. I don't know." And then I ended up auditioning again because my mom had a friend who moved to Denver, and it was her first time she was ever going to visit her. And because it was closed, she was like, "Will you come see us, and you can just hang out with us? I haven't seen you in a while. And by the way, So You Think You Can Dance is auditioning the same weekend, so you should audition." She convinced me to do it. I really didn't want to do it, and I made it a step further, but the same thing happened where I was just in my head, and I remember we were on the stage with Nigel.
Oh, so you went to a different city.
I went to a different city.
For the same season.
For the same season. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And that's insane.
I went the next, I made it a step further. It was not my choice. I did not want to do it, but I was like, why not? I guess I can learn something. I went a step further, and I was on stage in front of the judges, and Nigel, there were 5 of us, and he was like, "You can all go home. I never want to watch you dance again. Thank you." And I was like, okay, this is not my thing. This is really not my thing. And I just left, and I had given up on that. I was like, I don't, like, it's not for me. Like, whatever, I'll just keep auditioning and push forward. And I remember I was really bummed about it. And then season six came around, and it was an off season, and I was not going. Any bit of me was going. And my mom calls again, and we have this long conversation, and she's like, Kathryn, aren't you the one who always tells me that you can always learn something from every audition, even if it doesn't fit you at all?
Are you the one that says that?
Is
that
what you said? And I'm the one. So it's like, how are you supposed to say no when somebody twists your own wisdom on you?
To, like, practice what you preach. Yeah, walk the walk.
Like, okay. I was like, all right, I'll go. I would rather take class when I know I'm going to get something out of it, but okay, I'll go. So I went, and there was no pressure because I was like, I'm not going to make it, guys. So, like, mm-hmm. I'm just going to hang out with people and have fun. And I did. And then it was like, we got to the floor, and I chose contemporary. And I remember I was standing on number two. And I'm standing there, and then the CD player is messing up or whatever. So it's like one of those things, and you guys know too, like when you're about to perform or you're about to go into a scene or dance or whatever it is, you feel really ready. But if someone makes you wait,
oh,
it is the worst feeling. And all of those nerves build up, and you're just like, oh, I was ready. But then you have time to start thinking.
Right.
So my head started going, and I was just like gone again. And I was like, Kathryn, it was that battle. She was like, don't do this again. Don't do this again. And I remember, this is so cool. I remember I closed my eyes and I just said a prayer. And I was like, God, it's you and me. Like, it's you and me. Help me to truly believe that. Yeah, that's it. And I remember I opened my eyes and In the Arms of an Angel came on.
Oh, wow.
That was my song.
That's awesome.
And it's so crazy because it was everything that I was going through. And I just remember I went on the floor and all of a sudden I forgot about everything else. And I was totally back in my purpose, like what we were talking
cool.
about. And I just went on the floor, and for the first time, the producer looked at me, and he was just like, I want to see you again tomorrow. And he gave me a ticket, and then...
What is it, a golden ticket?
It's like a golden ticket.
Is it golden?
Willy Wonka style. And then he gave me a ticket, and then every day, like every audition from there on, because you go through like a week long of auditions, I thought it was over for me, because I was like, I've never made it past a hip-hop audition, and that was our first one, so I thought it was done, and I got passed. And, like, it kept happening that way to where it was just a space where I was just wanted to learn as much as I could. And I was like, I don't even know how I got here. So I just want to stand here and remember that moment that I had.
Oh, that's
when
awesome.
I start to doubt, I want to look back and be like, I don't know why I'm here, but I know I'm supposed to be. I don't feel like I'm as good as any of those people, but I know that I've got something good in me. So I want to be here until I can show it.
It's a great mantra.
That's really good.
Yeah, so I just... So there, and I ended up making it to the last girl standing. And it was all because I was just really wanted to learn as much as I could. And I made it to where I had nothing left to learn.
Wow.
And it was unbelievable.
Did you increase the amount of training you were doing in between auditions at that point? What were you doing to get better in between, you know, one to the next?
You take class and whatnot,
I take class a lot, for sure. I think you can take class every day, all day, and I think that your mind's stronger than that. You can make your muscles as strong and as big and as toned and as ripped as you want them to be, but your mind can destroy you.
Yeah, definitely.
That's awesome.
Totally.
So I mean, look at, I've been watching a lot of golf recently,
yeah.
and Tiger Woods, the best golfer on the planet, you know, his mind fucked with him.
Yeah.
And he ended up falling to like 139 or something like that,
yeah.
in the world from number one to, I mean, obviously he went through a lot of stuff, but that's
yeah.
all mind games,
mm-hmm.
you know? So the mind is powerful. So you're looking at the,
I was just making sure, cause the screen goes dark occasionally.
It sure
and I'm
does.
Like, then I saw that it was at like 245 and I wanted to make sure that you were still being recorded.
Yeah.
And that's those chunks you're talking
yeah,
about.
Yeah. If you look at the little red dot at the top,
right. That's still
okay.
working.
It's red.
Okay.
I can see it.
We're good.
Yeah.
Technology.
Yeah, but it's, the mind's a crazy thing. It's a really crazy thing. And it's like whatever, even like when it comes down to your day-to-day choices, like whatever you choose to put in your mind, you choose to believe, the time that you choose to spend with other people and where their hearts are, you don't think it really affects you, but it affects you so hard. And it's those little details that kind of build you up for the big opportunities. And when you're in those moments, if you haven't kind of prepared your heart for those, then you'll just crash and burn.
Yeah.
Preparation is
yeah.
everything.
Well, yeah, you know what I have the utmost respect for dancers.
Yeah.
Like, without a doubt. I'm going to talk about myself for a second. The story. Here's a story. I think you'll appreciate this. It's very Ryan Guzman. So I had never. I'm not a dancer. I'm a dancer. I could cut a rug. Oh, but I'm just saying, I've never actually taken choreography before.
Yeah.
And I auditioned. I was living in New York at the time, and I auditioned for a Target commercial. And, you know, I said, sure, okay, yeah, whatever, I'll dance.
What year is this?
This was...
He's trying to think of his name.
Because I auditioned for a Target commercial where I had to dance. Where
it was a Joe Boxer commercial for Target. So I auditioned in New York, and they're having the callbacks in L.A. They flew me out from New York to come to the callback. It's at Millennium. It's a dance studio in North Hollywood. Thomas didn't know that. He's not hip.
He's like, oh yeah.
I'm like, they have dance studios?
And it's exactly how you described it. You know, all the dancers are all in the same room. There's a table right in front with all the producers and the director and everybody. And all the dancers are sitting up against the wall. And then they call up a group, and it's like 8 or 10. For this one, there was every dancer in LA was there. And
so intimidating.
Yeah, right.
I'm not a dancer.
Wow.
Okay? Let me tell you something. What took the real dancers 5 minutes to memorize and to perfect took me 3 hours.
Wow.
Okay? 3 hours. You're laughing. It's not funny.
This is terrifying.
And then I had to do it.
That's a different story.
How did it go?
You can do it by yourself, but as soon as you get put on a spot, you're like, man, I lost my moves.
Oh, with the thing and the...
Well, here's the thing. Whenever I hate to suck at anything. I hate to suck at anything. So when I... Your face hurts right now. She's laughing too much. Whenever I just kind of give up, then I get goofy. You know, so I didn't take it serious. Because if I took it serious, I was going to get really pissed off.
Yeah,
because
at least if you're goofy, you can be like, I wasn't really trying.
Right, I wasn't even trying anyway.
Right, well, but then that was the thing where, you know, they didn't want to laugh at me. They want to see if I could perform.
Right.
And I had to do two. I had to do two dances. There was a hip-hop one, and then there was a salsa one. And
are you in your boxers this whole time?
No.
Right.
No, I was not. It would have been doubly... I don't even want to think about it. Ton of respect for what you guys do, because it's not easy. Mm-hmm. It's not easy, and it takes a lot of practice, lots of work.
So that's amazing, then, what Ryan pulled off for not having...
It's incredible. You watch him in the film, and he didn't have a double. Like, he fought that. They were just kind of like, okay, we're going to have a double for you. And he was like, no, I'm not. I'm not doing it. And he didn't. He did everything himself, and... It's really incredible.
Was he the only one that wasn't a professional? I mean, it looked like everyone else pretty much was a professional dancer.
Yeah.
Wow.
He was the only one.
Way to step up Revolution, Ryan.
Yeah, it was pretty amazing.
See what I did there?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm just distracted by the...
Airplane? The lawnmower. Airplane.
I'm having
it's real Los Angeles. You don't get any of that in London, real.
Everybody who's watching, I'm having a really good day with technology today. And being that lawnmowers are technology, I guess. There's so, motors. Yeah. I want to slap them in the face.
This is a random thought, but I was teaching this weekend in D.C. And there was this...
In D.C.?
In D.C. Washington? Saturday. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the cherry blossoms are so
pretty. Oh, isn't it beautiful?
Yeah, it's so pretty. I don't know why I'm telling you this.
Yeah, talk about it.
So I was teaching there, and then all of a sudden, we were all talking, and it sounded like a bird or something. I was like, is there a bird in here? And they were like, no, that's a baby.
A baby?
What? I just thought of that because I said, is that an airplane? And you're like, no, that's a lawnmower.
It's a lawnmower.
Wow, that's pretty far off, though, a bird and a human
really
baby.
I was like, whatever, same thing.
Whatever, wait, I know stuff.
So what are you teaching? What was that?
Tour, a lot of dancers will go and tour with different conventions. I kind of do more spot dates and spot places. So I'll tour with Dance Makers, Inc., which is a convention that it's really cool because I grew up taking dance there. Do you know what a convention is? You want me to tell you?
Yeah, tell us. Our listeners.
A dance convention, basically, there's so many of them now, and you'll have them every weekend. And so what will happen is, say they're in D.C., and then everybody from that area, if they choose to go to this convention, will come in, and they'll compete on Saturday night. So that's, like, the big thing that they come for. But you also have master classes, so they'll bring in master teachers from all over the country. And
do they invite managers and dance agents?
It'll just be, sometimes that's more of, like, the nationals. So they'll have, like, regional competitions throughout the year, and then the hand-selected that kind of won the regionals will go to nationals. And at nationals, you'll have, like, different people that kind
of
come
duets,
in.
Solos, all of it?
Scholarships and, yeah, different things. So they'll do that, and you'll have your dance company come in. It's, like, for the younger crowd, obviously, right. Like high school. And then they'll have master classes. So teachers come in and they teach class during the day on Saturday and on Sunday. And then they go home. So what I've been doing, I'll just go in like Friday night, I'll teach Saturday, and then I'll come home. So it's like half the weekend gone and half the weekend back in LA. And it's actually like, it's really fulfilling. And it was something that I never was interested in teaching. And I think a lot of it was a fear because I was just kind of like, I don't know what I'm young, like, I don't know what I really have to offer. I was afraid of choreography, and I think sometimes when we're afraid of things, even subconsciously, we write them off, and we're like, no, I'm not interested in that.
Right.
You know
right.
what I mean? When really, it's like, how do you know? Because you've never done it. So mm-hmm. why don't you try it, you know, and then maybe you'll realize that you have a passion. And it's been really cool because I've been traveling on the weekends, and more than anything, I love that I get to stand on a stage and not just teach cool moves, because that's not what it is for me. But
there is quite a bit of that, right?
Come on.
Okay.
But like to make choreography or pieces that mean something to me, to where I can kind of sit down with all of the dancers and just be like, okay, this is what I'm going through, and this is where I'm at, you know, and you all are artists, and your responsibility is to like bring up real life issues and things. Right. So just to talk about where I'm at and kind of encourage them that a lot of people will look at you if you've been seen on TV or different things, and they put you on this pedestal and it almost feels like you're unreachable or something. They're just like, man, you must have the best life ever. I wish I could be like you around that. And it's just like letting them know that like I'm the same as you are, you know, and I came from a really small town, and because I worked really hard and I loved it and my faith and all of those things together, I had really big opportunities. But just because those have been my opportunities and my journey, it doesn't mean that yours are any less just because they look different, you know. So
or because they're on a different scale.
Yeah, on a different scale, because right. that's huge. And mm-hmm. just realizing that each person has a different crowd that they can speak to. Each person is a leader if they choose to be. And if awesome. You go, like, you're never going to be able to be present in what your purpose is for your life if you're so worried about trying to fit someone else's. So it's like trying to encourage people to just like start to ask yourself, like, what do you really love? And a lot of times we're like, well, what if I love doesn't seem like good enough? What if it's not good enough in the idea or the eyes of everyone else? So then all of a sudden those dreams are squashed because you're like, no, it doesn't measure up to like what I think I should be doing because that's cooler. That's like success.
I think most people fight with that every single day,
yeah.
especially if they're in some role in the professional world. If you work at Dell in a cubicle or Dell, I don't know why I said Dell, but I have yeah. Dell was in Austin, and that's where I was. And so I knew a lot of people that went into that industry, and they were in yeah. sales or whatever, and they may not have liked it, but that's common. I think more people than you know are constantly going, oh, is what I'm doing good enough?
Socially I'm closing. Accepted, and it's what
right.
is when you're
and it gets
growing
tied
up.
Into age in this society. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, I'm close to 30 or I'm close to 40, and look what I've done with my life.
Yeah, but I think when you're doing things that you're not really right for, it becomes so empty, so empty.
Well, then you can't be free either. You know, when you're right for it, and your yeah. heart tells you you're right for it, and it's meant to be
yeah.
because it feels right. Then you're free to do anything. You can't make a mistake. You're not nervous.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can be yourself.
Yeah.
And then really that inner, your heart shows and you start
yeah.
to shine.
You know? It was really cool. I took yoga last night. I love yoga.
Nice.
And I was taking it last night.
Was it
night
hot yoga?
No, it wasn't hot yoga. Huh. It was like vinyasa flow. I take hot yoga sometimes, but it was like vinyasa flow. This hardcore like Russian woman, but she looks like a Barbie. So she's just really funny.
Wow.
She's really intense, but at the same time you look at her and you're just like, where is this coming from? It's awesome. But that's not the point. Anyway, afterwards, there was this guy, and he came up to me, and we'll see each other in class a lot just in passing, but we've never really talked. And it was cool because we just started talking, and he was just asking, like, what do you do? Like, and I was asking him different things about him, and we started talking about television and film and different things, and he's like, yeah, it's crazy because I used to be in television, and I used to produce a lot, and this or that, but he was just like, it got to a point.
Was it Eric Estrada?
No. Got to a point when he was like, I'm really drained. Really? Come on, this is serious. You're ruining my flow.
Sorry, go ahead.
And he's like, I just got to a point when I was really drained and I didn't know if I wanted it anymore. And I was like, what do you do now? And he's like, I sell ambulances.
What?
I sell ambulances. And he was like, I gotta tell you, it's more fulfilling than anything I have ever done in my life.
That's weird.
And I was like, what? And he was like, yeah, but just like supplying trucks and being able to be around people who really need that help and like being able to even like go to hospitals and like different things. He was just like, it's so amazing to be kind of more in like reality rather than like chasing a dream of just.
And
like,
he found that much later, right?
Yeah, and he found
so when did he change?
Later. He has to be in his 40s or something.
Wow.
So I know he hasn't been doing it for too long, but it's still like, it's really cool because a lot of people look at that like, oh, you gave up. You just chose to sell ambulances now. But for him to be like so passionate, I could see his eyes were like sparkling.
That's great.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, man, that's amazing. Because so many people would be like, oh, that's a step down in the industry.
Yeah.
And because that is, then all of a sudden you're less and you're lazy and you gave up and... That's not the case.
That's such a Hollywood mentality to be like, oh, you had it all, and now you're doing something that will never, you know, improve your career in that regard. And it's good to remember that making movies is a lot of fun, but it's not, you know.
Well, it reminds me of...
it's not everything.
A Cameron quote. Cameron, our acting teacher. When you follow your dream with all your heart, the heart of your dream comes true. Mm-hmm. So you don't necessarily know why you're doing what you're doing, but you just love to do it because you're following your dream. It's our tagline, live the dream.
Live the dream, yeah.
And it seems like you're like the poster child for it because you're just living your dream. You just wanted to do what you imagined for yourself, what your parents kind of set up for you since that's what they did, right?
Yeah, my dad was a golfer. We grew up right
down
the street from Augusta National.
So I'm loving golf right now.
Yeah, my dad was a golfer, and then my mom was a dancer, and then they had me and my sister when they were really young. So they stopped that, and he went into cable, and she went to become a nurse. So it was like they completely shifted.
That's wild.
But they knew what it was like to have a dream and want to pursue it and not really be able to, so they're extremely supportive of me, but they didn't really know how to tell me how to do it. They were just like, whatever you need, we got you, but like we don't know how to do it. So they were terrified, but very supportive.
Let's talk about Cameron for a second because he's sort of the catalyst. He brought us all together. We all train with Cameron at his studio, Cameron Thor, and was he brought on? Is that how you met him? Because he was brought on to Step Up Revolution.
I met Cameron Thor through Step Up. So that was my first time really ever with an acting coach, and Cameron is just unbelievable. His energy, he just glows. You know, he was a guy that would walk in the room, and I remember that I was so intimidated because I was just like, I don't know how to do this, people. Like, we're having coachings for acting, and we're filming in a couple weeks, and I was like, am I supposed to memorize the whole script? Like,
how many weeks of rehearsal did you have?
With Cameron? We had a couple weekends, but really that's it.
That's it? Yeah. And was he training everybody or just you?
Just Ryan and I and
just
Misha, the third character. So it was like, we had a couple coachings, but with like dance rehearsals, we had a whole month where we were dancing every day, 9 to 5. With acting, it was like, okay, we're going to spend a couple weekends, and then we were kind of on our own.
Acting's not important.
We were on our own, so it was so terrifying.
Well, here's the thing. I mean, now that you know,
yeah.
I mean, for people who aren't actors or haven't been on a set, I mean, it could be intimidating, it could be daunting, the having to think that you have to memorize the entire script,
right.
But you do a scene that's, what, three pages maybe, if that, and you do that scene 30, 40 times.
Yeah, it just gets in your body.
Of course. So by that last take, which is sometimes the one that they use, when they say cut, check the gate, and move on, it's because they know they got it.
It's like when you get frustrated and your emotions take over, you forget to care so much. You forget to care so much.
How did Scott shoot? Did you guys do a bunch of takes for each
setup? Did a lot of takes. He was one of those directors that really wanted to make sure he got everything. But the thing about him was, it was really cool because he would bring in Ryan, Misha, and I every Sunday to his condo, and we'd go over our scenes, which doesn't happen very often.
No, that's not normal. It doesn't happen
at all, but he would just bring us in, and he would just wanted to help us and wanted to, like, be more prepared and also have this connection that was, like, when we were on set and we had all of these other people around us and things going on and technical things and hair and makeup and all that stuff, we could look at each other and be like, come on, pick it up. Like, you got this. And I know you do because I was there. You know, so it was really cool. We had a really strong connection in that. And I felt like Scott just knew a lot about me personally. And, like, we had opened up a lot. And so I feel like he knew where I was coming from on a lot of things. So he was just completely honest. And I think that was the best thing for me, especially when you're already really hard on yourself.
Yeah.
So I'm really hard on myself. And I want everything to be great. As a dancer, that perfectionist quality is your worst enemy. So trying to shake that off and him just look at me and be like, I didn't believe you. Or him to look at me and be like, all right, that's getting better. Or to look at me and be like, what does this mean to you? And for me to start talking, and then it actually pours out and he's like, action. You know what I mean? He just knew how to, like, really be, he was just so supportive and there with me. But there were times when we were on set and I was just like, man, I want him to get away from me. And we were so mad at each other and just butting heads. But, like, he just sat in it and he was like, this is what it's supposed to be.
Wow.
But for me, realizing now, like, after being in class with Cameron, I look now and all the things that I was learning on set make sense now. But on set, I was like, I don't understand why they're telling me I have to stand on this mark. How am I supposed to have this emotion when I have to stand on this mark so tight? What do you mean? I went an inch over. Sorry. Like, you know, I didn't understand. And now I go into class and I see Cameron talking about these things and I see him almost like picking at people to get them frustrated. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden you see as this completely different person comes alive. And so now I look back and I'm like, he was playing games with me this whole time. And I had no idea.
That's Scott, correct? Yeah. Just getting what he needed for that particular take. You know, when you were frustrated, it's because you needed to be frustrated in the scene.
Yeah. And he knew how to do it. Yeah.
That's why
Is he passionate about dance, Scott?
I think he has become more and more passionate about dance. He was never a dancer, you know, didn't have much of a dance background by any means, but was really good friends with John Chu, who was the director of the Step Up 2 and 3.
Oh, okay.
So through that, he was really connected and was, it's crazy. It's hard not to be passionate about dance when you're surrounded by people who love it so much.
I was passionate about dance by the end of that film. And
it's hard.
That's saying a lot. You know?
Yeah, it's just a beautiful art form, and it's like blood, sweat, and tears. It really is. It's hard work, and when you're around that, you kind of just have this love for it. It's like that mystery thing that if you don't know anything about it, you have a different passion because you're just like, I don't understand, and wow, they'll like work until they're dead.
Did you guys see Senna, the autobiography about the F1 driver?
I haven't watched it yet.
That's the same thing. It's like something totally foreign to me.
Yeah.
F1 racing, it's just not big in the US, or it's getting bigger now, but internationally it's huge. You see this documentary, I said autobiography. You see this documentary and you're like, race car driving is actually really cool. And that's how I felt about dance, because it's always been sort of peripheral to me, you know? And like, I remember the Fly Girls in Living Color, that TV show, but that kind of dance has been sort of under the radar in the circles of it. But I mean, after you see that, I mean, the opening sequence is pretty crazy, right? Mm-hmm. You weren't involved in that.
No, I wasn't in the opening. But I was on set. I was really good friends with the crafty guy. And nice. I love smoothies. So we would come up with different recipes. And on set, it was so hot. And these guys were, like, in leather jackets and pants and burning on top of cars in Miami in the summer. It was terrible. So I would just walk around and I'm like, watermelon juice, anyone? And I would just make smoothies for people.
It looked really good, though. It was awesome. It must have been a lot of work because it's massive. The scale is just huge.
And so, it was cool because the actual residents in Miami, like, stood around and could watch it during the day. So some people that you see were actually real people just watching.
Free extras.
Really cool. Yep.
Right. Production value. That.
So, your first movie.
Yeah.
Your first lead.
Yeah.
What do you take from it? Like, do you look back and like, man, I'm so proud of that film. I can't believe that this is where it started for me.
Yeah, it took a lot for me to not be critical. It's a really hard thing, especially seeing your face that big on the screen and other things that big on the screen. You're just like, man, I remember being in it, and I've even heard this, like, listening to different interviews from different actors or actresses, and a lot of times when you're in a film, you're so caught up by the emotion in your character that it doesn't feel good sometimes, depending on what you're going through. And I feel like Emily in the film had so much of this internal battle and struggle and insecurity and fears and falling in love for the first time but unsure about it, and battle between that and her relationship with her family. And I feel like a lot of that was so relatable for me, and even too, like, the frustration or the insecurity was coming from doing something new that I had never felt before.
Sounds like you didn't have to do a lot of acting.
Yeah, there was a lot of acting.
It was real for me. So in it, I remember there'd be times that I was just like, I'm gonna make such a fool out of myself.
Really?
I was like, I'm so embarrassed. I would walk away off set and I was like, I'm so embarrassed. Because it's a different thing. When you're dancing, you get applause. And all of a sudden, you know if it was good or it wasn't. Mm. In acting, they're like, okay, all right, that's a wrap. And nobody says anything, and you don't get any feedback, and you don't see anything. And it didn't always feel good.
Yeah.
So you're like, I don't really know how that was at all. So I remember there would be days on set that I would surprise myself, and I'd be like, wow, that was really cool. And I'd walk away and be like, wow, I'm so grateful and I'm learning so much. And just like, this is an opportunity of a lifetime. And then there would be days and I'd walk off and I'd just be like, this is the end of my career. And this is terrible. And would just be so upset about it. But then I remember when I walked in and we had a screening for the first time. And I sat down and I was shaking.
Were you really?
I was like, oh man, here we go.
And did you have to ADR or anything like that?
We did a ton of ADR.
So you saw some of the scenes prior.
But he would never let me watch all the way through or anything. Like, he was just very, like, didn't want us to see too much of it. So I remember I sat down for the first time and just shaking. And as soon as the first credit came up, I was in tears. And I was just so proud of it. And afterwards, yeah, there were moments that I was like, oh, yep, that happened and I could do without that scene. But like, afterwards, I was just like, wow, I just watched 3 months of my life, and everybody sees this film, but I see, like, this evolution that happened inside of me. So it's neat to watch a film, and you see what you were actually feeling in the day. Yeah. So it was a really cool thing to be able to look back on that, and then I watched it the second time, and I was like, that was terrible.
Oh, wow, like, really?
Every time you watch it, you see different things.
Yeah.
And the first time, I was just overwhelmed and so excited and so proud because I gave everything that I had and everything that I knew. So I'm going to be proud. And I know that there was so much for me to learn, and I've learned so much, and there's still more. But that's not going to take away from what I knew then and how hard we worked on it and the experience that I had. But then you watch it the second time and I'm just like, man, that was terrible. And you become really critical. And then you watch it again and you're like, wait, that wasn't so bad. But that, did you see that? You know, so it's like, it never ends. And it's one of those things that we're just like our worst critic. So, I'm extremely proud of it. Yeah, there are things that I look at now and I'm like, if I could just do that again,
yeah,
it's different, but
So a lot of the film is it's the mob. There's this crew of dancers that goes around. They're trying to get 10 million hits on YouTube. And yeah. I don't want to give away the movie for people who haven't seen it. But in the course of this, they're trying to earn 100,000. They're trying to win 100 grand, right?
Yeah.
But while they're putting on these mob things, it looks like each thing that they put on costs about 200 grand. How does that work?
Totally. Well, if you see, they're really, really good friends with the costume girl.
Oh, so they right, get right, free right. Costumes. They get a lot of free shit.
We were talking about that actually indie filmmakers in the film. And we were like, so how are people really going to believe this? But I think that in any film you have those things.
It's magic. It's magical. Yeah. And yeah, so it's magical. Now we'll get to the important thing. Christian wanted to know what it was like to work with Peter Gallagher's eyebrows.
That's not a question that I asked. That Thomas is obsessed with eyebrows. He like licks yeah. mine for
particularly
some reason.
Peter Gallagher's because he has like the standard.
Peter Gallagher is incredible. His eyebrows, Peter Gallagher.
Right?
Just kidding. No, Peter was actually my first scene I ever did. So on top of it being your first film and then walking on with somebody who's so seasoned.
The scene on the rooftop little table?
Yeah, it was in a pink dress. That was my first scene. Well, there was one other scene, but that didn't make it.
That was the first time you opened your mouth on film.
Yeah.
Wow.
With Peter Gallagher.
With Peter Gallagher? Some people are born lucky.
He is an incredible man.
Yeah.
Just such an amazing guy. So down to earth. Like, I remember when we met him for the first time and we're just sitting in this little conference office in a hotel and he walks in like his little swim trunks and sailor hat or whatever and he's just
is that
like,
what he was wearing?
Hey guys, yeah, like super casual and just kind of like told telling you, us all of these stories PG. About different things and he has such a passion for dance because he used to be a dancer and is really big into all art forms, even acting, singing, dancing. And it would be really cool because I remember he walked in the makeup trailer and I'm getting ready and it's the first day, so it was like a big deal. And he walks in and he's just like, how do you feel about all this? He's like looking at the sides. He's like, how do you feel about all this? Like, is there anything that feels uncomfortable? And he's like, can we just read through it? He's like real casual and they're like cutting his hair and different things. And I'm like, okay. So, like, huh. So we're just talking and we're like reading through it and he's like, I think this line's a little bit weird. So we were like morphing the scene together, which the director was really cool about that. He was nice. Like, if there's anything that you feel is uncomfortable, just talk about it and then we'll talk about it and see, unless it's like a line like break the rules, like we really need. And mm-hmm. we're like, come on.
Anyway, right.
So yeah, so we just talked about it and it made me really comfortable to see that he was like trusting my opinion, and he wanted to hear my feedback, and he's like, okay, how do you feel, this or that, and he's like, all right, let's go, and we went up on set, and the cool thing about him was that he would give me little tips of advice, but he would never tell me what to do or how to do it. It would never be like...
Like a fucking pro.
It would
That's
never
amazing.
Be like, oh, I've done this before, why are you doing that, or why are you doing this? He would kind of just sit back and let me have my experience with it and figure it out.
Nobody wants to be told what to do,
yeah.
you know?
But you'd think that, I don't know, you never know how someone like that could feel really entitled, especially in a dance film, or, you know, they could feel that way, but he wasn't. And one of the biggest things that I remember him telling me, it was a balcony scene. And I remember standing there, and I was playing with my bracelet. So I'm just playing with my bracelet, and I'm supposed to be, like, apologizing to him because I just got caught in the mob for the first time. And so I'm just sitting there, and we're doing the scene, and then we had a break. And it's one of those things that's really hard to work yourself up emotionally and then be like, lunch.
Yeah.
And you're like, no, I was almost there. And then now we have to have lunch, and then you go, and you have to come back. So it's one of those things. We were having lunch, and we were just talking, and he's like, what are you thinking about, like, whenever you're playing with your bracelet and stuff? And I was just talking to him, and I don't know what I was thinking about at the time, and he was like, one of the biggest things that I learned, he's like, whenever you're in a scene and you have an action, do the action. Like, count how many beads it takes until it gets to that one hook, and then try to say your lines. Don't try to say your lines and then try to figure out what action fits it.
Right.
He's like, no, it'll just work. He's just like, really just be focused on what you're doing and what color it is and counting it, and then try to see if you remember them and see what happens. And I had never heard that before. I was like, I didn't, okay. Like, And it completely changed the day after that.
Right.
So it was like he would constantly give me like these little tips and little
drop
words.
Little gems on
little
you.
Pearls.
Wisdom and like different call them gems. Things. Yeah, and by the end of it, it was just really cool to see where we started. And by the end, when we did the finale scene, that was literally one of his last days, and he brought his wife on set. And they were just watching the dance. He had seen it the day before and brought her in the next day because he wanted her to see it, and was just literally in tears because he felt the passion behind it and loved it so much. And by the end, you could just see like this look in his eye that was looking at us that he was super, super proud because he had been there the whole time.
How long did that final sequence take? Because that thing is
huge.
We
were there for a good week.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. A good week.
There's like all kinds of stuff going on. It's amazing. You should
like
see it.
Some of everything that you see. It's really cool. Yeah.
I want to see your film. Everybody should see her film.
Step Up Revolution. I think it's on iTunes now. So it's moving down from theaters to Netflix. Yeah.
But I mean, but it's out there.
But
you know,
it's all
over the place. Yeah.
Technology.
Yeah.
It was not my friend.
Do they talk about bringing you back after that?
They're writing a Step Up 5 right now. So they're writing that, and then they haven't asked me. Obviously, they want to try to use all the characters from the past and have, like, a final one and it be done, I think. But they're still writing it, and I'm not sure. So I could see that, definitely, but I don't know yet. I can't say for sure because no one's seen, you know, the storyline or what they're writing about.
Is it the same group of writers, or is it somebody?
It's a different writer.
Really? Okay.
They just know that it's a money-making machine.
Yeah.
People want to see it.
It's like the biggest dance franchise that there is. Mm-hmm. So it's like a really one of those things that they're like, should we make a Step Up 5? Because we felt like 4 ended on a good note. But at the same time,
but
they're
why
like,
wouldn't we?
Why
because,
not?
Yeah.
Let's see.
For real.
Yeah.
Can we talk about the training?
What
do you do besides dance? Do you lift weights? I know you do yoga.
Just on every day?
Yeah.
Well, I take a lot of ballet,
okay.
which I love so much. Ballet is, you look at ballet dancers sometimes if you're not a dancer and you're like, they're so fragile and they're this.
Yeah.
Like, ballet is one of the hardest art forms you will ever try. It is so.
I'll never try it.
It is. It's so hard because it's one of those things that like, you have to be so aware of your body. And once you kind of unlock one piece of it, it opens the door and you realize that you are so lost and you have so much to learn. So I crave it because I'm always wanting to go deeper and wanting to understand, like, what muscle do I use to lift my leg and, like, how do you lengthen? Like, a lot of dance is, like, pulling your legs out of the sockets and, like, different things. And it's, like, how do you do that? You know, and, like, getting out of your quads and all of this stuff. But, like, you don't learn that until, like, you actually are aware of the different parts of your body. So I love ballet. I just got into gyrotonic, which is not too many people know about it. I think it's starting to kind of become a fad a little bit.
That's usually what I get in summertime. It's a great cocktail.
Gyrotonic.
Yeah.
No, it's awesome. It's so good. It, like, lengthens through every vertebrae, and it's just, like, I'm starting to understand
so like
my core. It the machine similarly, like, it kind of looks like a Pilates machine. It's a lot different, but it's one of those things. It's not yoga. It's not Pilates. It's not dance, but it just helps you, like, work through, like, your core in a different way, and it brings everything kind of in the center, whereas, like, I can't really explain it.
Gyrotonic.
You have to do it. Gyrotonic is amazing, and it's all circular positions and just lengthening through your joints.
Is that fairly widespread, or is that just a Los Angeles thing?
It is widespread.
Yeah?
Yeah, they have it. I mean, they have it in New York for sure. They'll have it in bigger cities. I'm not sure. They don't have it where I'm from. I had never heard of it. But it's a workout that has just made me so strong. Stronger. It, like, will point out every single weak spot that you have, and you can strengthen it. And then I use it for my dancing because I'll go to gyro, and then I go into ballet, and I'm so much stronger in the right places. So that's awesome. I do vinyasa flow yoga,
mm-hmm.
which, as a dancer, a lot of times your upper body can be fairly weak. And you have, like, stronger thighs and different things, but yoga, the kind that I take, it's a lot of inversions and different things like that, so I've gained so much strength in my arms, and you don't realize, like, that helps you so much in your dancing, but you have to do a little bit of the cross training to actually
right.
make your body ready for that. And so do yoga, and then I'll take random classes just as much as I can during the week, whether it's hip-hop or contemporary or jazz funk or
and you sweat.
Anything tap. I love sweating.
You sweat. Not you sweat, but I the sweat. Hypothetical you.
I sweat like a man.
You sweat in class.
She does sweat like a man. I've seen it.
My legs, it's the type of thing that it's like, if I wear shorts in a class and I'm sweating and there's floor work, everyone's falling because I'm so wet for my legs and I can't even sit on my knees because I'm like slipping, I'm slipping, slide all over the place. But it's a weird thing. Like, I love sweat and blood and bruises. It's one of those things that, like, if I walk away and I have, like, a big bruise on my leg, I'm like, yes. Like, I went for it. Yeah. And it's like, I love waking up and being so sore that I can't move because I feel accomplished.
Yeah. Have you had to deal with any significant injuries in your dance career?
I actually had my biggest injury this December that I've ever really had because... I sprained both of my ankles at the same time, like, years ago, so that was a little bit
awkward. At the same time?
Yeah, how does that happen?
Like, in the same moment?
Yes, it was terrible.
Stop laughing.
Sorry to laugh at that. I just imagined it. Probably like, hurt really bad.
It was like one and then 5 minutes later, the other. Okay. It was really terrible. Right. No, but you want to hear the story? Because we were doing this piece. I was in high school, and it's called The Red Door. So there's, like, this door, and it has two little things. What are those called?
Hinges?
Prongs. Pogs.
Pogs. Which part of the door are you talking about?
There's a door and there's two things that they put on there to
prop it up. Yeah, okay.
So you can step on it. So we're dancing on them. And I go to step off. There's like a ledge that rolls and then it has the door and then there's the ground down here.
Right.
So I went to step off and I stepped sideways on it and I twisted my ankle. Ooh. So I sprained my ankle. Mm. So then we start icing it and we're wrapping it and everything. And then my mom comes in and I'm being a fool. And I was like, Mom, you want to know what happened? And I start jumping around on the other foot and I jump up and do this big jump and I landed on that ankle. And so I twisted both of my ankles at the same time. And I was like, this is terrible.
For a dancer, it's very terrible.
Dancers are so clumsy when they're not actually giving choreography. So twisted those, but this December, I actually, my sacrum, so you have your pelvis, and my muscles have been so tight from taking classes and not getting body work, because your body can get out of alignment even if your muscles are tight. So my muscles are tight, and it was pulling my pelvis out of alignment because one was pulling this way and one was pulling that way. And then from there, my sacrum started twisting.
Wow.
And my sacrum was twisting and hitting my SI joint. So it got to a point where I couldn't touch my toes because it was hitting that point and I was really stiff, like, in one area. So I didn't dance for the whole month of December trying to figure it out. I didn't know what it was.
That must have been agony for you, right?
Oh my gosh.
Like, not dancing is like fish out of water.
It was so hard because in that time, this was my first, like, pilot season and all of that was about to happen. There were a couple auditions before December before that happened, but so I had been auditioning a little but not too much, and it got really slow right before Christmas, so that was really slow on top of not being able to dance. And I realized a lot about myself just being a person that, and I'm sure a lot of you can relate, or you guys can relate, that it's like I've always been a person that's like, I never wanted to give myself free time or time to relax and spend time with people unless I earned it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I had to work hard enough, sweat hard enough, mentally be exhausted enough, or whatever it is, or make sure I got all of my to-do list done. And if that wasn't done, then it's almost like I don't deserve to be hanging out with people because there's work to be done.
I'll give you a pound on that one.
Yeah, we
so that's like this. A really like hard thing and hard mindset to get out of. So to be in a place where I had no choice, because it was like, okay, I don't have any auditions today, and I would fill up my day with dance classes, but I can't dance. So I just had to call friends and hang out with them because I was like, I don't deserve this, but
I
was like, I don't have anything to do. But I gotta tell you, like, in that month, once I kind of started getting over the fact that I felt like I was getting really behind in my art form, I had more joy than I had ever really felt. And it was because I was spending time with people. And I think that when we get in this industry and we start running this race, we forget to live. We forget to live life because we're trying to recreate life.
Yeah.
You know, or whatever it is. And so it's just kind of like, I forgot how much being around friends made me learn about myself or find this joy that even when you feel like you have opportunities that are everywhere and you're working hard, it's like you can still have this emptiness and you're like, everything's so good. So why am I waking up sad? Like, what is it? And I think we all have that hole in us. So it's like, I realize that it's okay to take time and that you actually are moving forward by standing in a moment with people and building relationships. And you go back into what you love and you actually fall in love with it deeper because you don't exhaust it.
Right.
You take what you take what you learn from your, you know, you go away from what you love.
Yeah.
And you come back and you're rejuvenated.
Yeah.
But this time it took you getting injured to appreciate it. So will you learn from that and schedule time off next time instead of waiting until you get hurt again? That's the question.
Right. It's like I definitely have spent a lot more time with friends than I ever have. And lately I was actually talking about this last night. I was like, man, I'm isolating myself again so much because I just want to be working. And I want to keep up with dance and I want to pursue acting and I want to be teaching and I want to go here and I want to clean my room because it's a wreck. And I want to, and so she was like, all these things. And you're like, there's no time. But at the end of the day, like, you have to make time because your heart and your soul is the most important thing. And you're never going to be able to go anywhere in your career, anywhere that's like fulfilling or worth it, if you're not taking care of yourself. And also too, knowing that like it's not just about you, like there's people in your life that really need you. They just need some support and they need a friend. And I think at the end of the day, I'm trying to remember that this life is way greater than what we think we're here for. And we think that we're here to dance, we think that we're here to act, we think that we're here to make great movies or whatever it is. But I think when you're in those settings, there's actually like little magical moments that you can find if you're just really in tune. And it's like, I come here with you guys and it's like, yeah, we're doing an interview. No, we're not. Like, there's something deeper, you know, whether it's something that you say or I say or something that you connect to and you take away from it and you're like, wow, that was really the point. Like, oh, I did a film, great. But that wasn't the point. The point was that I walked away, and one, I realized what I'm capable of, and two, I realized how guarded I was as a person and how beautiful my insecurities and struggles and fears are if I choose to let them out. So it's like, it's never about, it's just never about what you think it is. And if it is about what you think it is, then it's just going to be a really long, sad
ride. So if you were going to advise young girls or young men who are trying to do what you do, is that, what would you tell them? Would you say, hey, it's not all about just making this amount of money or getting this job or what?
I think it's hard because you just look at people in their path and then you want to be that. And I don't think that's realistic. I think it's a great thing to look at people and be inspired by them and be like, wow, I really admire them. Mm. But for me, it's always been like, why? Why do you admire them? Do you admire just their work or do you admire the person that they are? Like their heart.
I think, you know, you mentioned a lot of things like we're out, we're making movies, we're wanting to be on a television show or we're doing the things that we're doing, but why, right?
But why?
And the, one of the reasons that we do the show is to inspire people, and like I'm inspired.
The way you talk, Kathryn, is amazing.
And ultimately, it's like we just want love.
Yeah.
Regardless, like okay, so you're on a million billboards, and your movie made $150 million, and so on and so forth. But you know that doesn't mean anything.
Yeah. Could,
but what you were doing was for the love.
Yeah.
You did it for the love of your dance. You did it for the love of your craft.
Yeah.
And you love dancing.
So much.
Yeah.
It's to be able to do that and then know you have that many more people that you can be a voice to. You know, this is an industry that we get put in the spotlight and then we're able to influence so many people. And I think a lot of people forget that, you know, and you forget that you have people looking up to you. So it's like, what do you stand for? Why do you do what you do? Because that's important. And you know that growing up, there were people that I looked at and I was like, I want to be her.
Who would that be? Who are your idols when you were coming up?
Growing up, Britt Nicole. She is a singer-songwriter. This is really cool, too. I'm going to tell you this story. So she's a singer-songwriter that I grew up and I really, really loved her music. It was one of those artists that comes on the radio and you're like, have we lived the same life? Because I feel like she, everything I was going through would be exactly what she'd be talking about in her music. So I was just kind of like, this is really cool. And it would always be really inspiring to me. And so I loved her stuff. And I remember I was a senior in high school. And as a senior in high school at my dance studio, you had to choreograph your own solo to compete at nationals. And I was like, ugh, I don't do choreography and I don't know. And I wanted to use this song, but she's like a Christian singer-songwriter. So to me, that was really special. But to other people, they can think that's really lame. Mm. So they're like, oh, I wanted to dance to one of her songs, but then it was this battle because I was like, I don't know, people are going to think this isn't cool. And on top of that, if I don't have good choreography and they don't like the song because they're not passionate, this is really going to go downhill. And I remember that I was just sitting in that space, and so I decided to pick like this almost like techno song. It was like, it was not my style at all, but I was like, yeah, this song's awesome.
This is cool.
But I was like, I don't even know how to move to this. I was like trying to figure it out. And then I remember that I was sitting at a service one day, and the whole theme was like, it's called Lion Chasers, and it's like, what God wants for your life is hanging behind your biggest fear, your toughest decision. And I was like, what's my toughest decision? And I was like, a song choice. Sounds really lame. So I was like, okay. But in that moment, it really was. Like, that was what was on my mind. So I was like, okay. And then I was like, all right, what if what you're supposed to do is hiding behind that? And I was like, I'm supposed to use this song. It was one of those things that made me think of it, and then I'd get in the car every day, and it would come on the radio. And I was like,
no way.
I was like, I'm supposed to use this song, but I'm really afraid of it because I feel stupid, and I don't want to. But then I was like, no, I'm going to use it. I ended up choreographing this dance to the song, which the choreography was better because it actually meant something to me. And after that, I was just kind of like, okay, that was really cool, whatever. So then, years passed. I moved to L.A. That was in high school. I moved to L.A., I do So You Think You Dance, all this stuff, and then I get offered this tour called the Revolve Tour, which was a motivational speaking tour, and they came to my dance agent, and they asked me to come in, we want to have a conference for you about an opportunity, and they tell me it's speaking. That was my biggest fear, public speaking. I was like, are you sure they have the right person? Because I'm not sure about this. They ended up asking me to come in, and they were like, yeah, we think you're perfect for it. I kind of told the story of how I got started with you guys, and the theme was Dream On, so they're like, it's perfect, like, it fits, and you have such a following with dance, and there'll be a lot of people who don't know you as a dancer at all and different things, so I ended up talking about that, and I would literally talk, like, 5 minutes on Friday night, 20 minutes on Saturday, and afterwards I'd do a little piece that kind of summed up whatever I was talking about. And so I'm trying to decide if I'm going to do this. And it's one of those things that, like, when one of your biggest fears dangled in front of your face, you're like, I could choose to do this and maybe fall on my face, or I could choose not to do this and just stay the same.
Save some dignity.
And I was like, I feel like I'm more ready for this than I think. And I have just, like, seen so many speakers or different people talk, and they have changed my perspective on life. And who's to say they weren't afraid either? So I was like, I think I'm supposed to do this, and I ended up diving in, but whenever I was thinking about it, I go online, and I'm like, therevolvetour.com, so I'm looking. The first face that pops up is Britt Nicole.
No way. And I was like,
what? Britt Nicole? It's like, what? She was supposed to be one of the singers on the tour. And I was like, this is really crazy. So I end up joining the tour, Britt's on the tour, and then on Friday night, you're just supposed to have, like, you just talk for about 5 minutes and just have, like, one message that you're trying to give. And my whole thing was about, like, choices that you make in your life and, like, the small, tiny decisions. And those little decisions prepare you for the big opportunities in your life. And if you can't be trusted with little, tiny decisions, then how are you supposed to be given big opportunities? Because you'll crumble. And that was my point. And in that, I told the story of trying to decide for the solo or not, and then I ended up coming out and Britt Nicole sang the song that I did my solo to, and I performed my solo with Britt Nicole singing live.
Wow.
And we did that for about 12 weekends, and we toured together, and now we're the best of friends.
What a dream come true that must have been.
So
that's
like
amazing.
A really crazy feeling to be able to really look up to someone, not because they're crazy talented, she is, you know, she's an incredible singer, but more than anything, I loved her heart, and I really admired her path of life. And so it's crazy how she inspired me in dance when she wasn't a dancer, but because of her passion and her heart and just love, that's what inspired me to want to tell deeper stories in my art form.
Do you feel any special kind of pressure, being that you are you're Christian and, yep. and you talk about that quite a bit. Do you feel any pressure?
I'm Christian too. Wait a minute.
What?
That's just your name.
That's your name.
Like when you are you afraid of doing certain things because it's just such a further fall if somebody disapproves within that community? You know, I thought about this yesterday because there's an opening sequence in Step Up Revolution when you, the two characters, the protagonists, are meet each other.
Uh-huh.
You guys have a pretty racy dance.
Yeah, we did.
Right?
Those butt rolls, they played them 3 times. For real? Like, come on, Scott!
Exactly. Like, I was like, wow, this is pretty racy. Like, how was that accepted back home and in the more conservative Christian circles?
Yeah.
You're a role model now, totally. Kathryn. So that's a lot of pressure now.
I mean, there is a pressure, but at the end of the day, I think it comes down to you and God, and it comes down to me and God and how I feel about those things. And I know the person that I am and what I want to represent and what I want to say. And I think that sometimes I don't feel like there was anything wrong with it. You know, I think it just depends. Like, there's a lot of groups that can be in, like, there's a big difference between, like, religion and all the rules that you can have. And, like, this is supposed to be this way or that way. And then it's like, where's the love in that? I think that sometimes, just because you're a Christian, it doesn't mean that you have to be around just Christian people all the time. You know, life is real and things happen.
Life is real.
And just because you're a Christian, it doesn't mean that you don't face everything that everyone else does. You know, so it's one of those things that you choose to dive into all of those different places. And there's things that I've been sent on auditions for, and I'm like, I'm not going to audition for that.
Right.
I don't want to be seen, you know, with my shirt off, or I'm not trashy like that. And so I think that you can represent a kind of sensuality in a classy way. I think that that is possible. And I think that people do question that. But at the end of the day, it comes down to how you feel and how you and God feel. Not if you try to live the world trying to please everyone, you're going to fail, you know? And I think it's really hard. It used to be really hard for me because I didn't grow up in a Christian home. Like, I grew up, my mom was Catholic and my dad was just kind of believed in God but didn't really pursue God. And so it was one of those things where we'd go to church on Christmas sometimes, but it was never a big part of my life. And as I got older and met a friend in middle school, we started to go to a Baptist church. But then that even too, it was just kind of like I felt so much pressure to get dressed up or like really, we'd go to Bible school and I'd be like, I don't know any of these names and I don't know any of these stories. And I was so intimidated that I wasn't going to be enough. And I totally lost the point of it because I was out here like feeling like I needed to impress everyone.
Right.
Then I got into high school and I started to go to this non-denominational church, and I just really fell in love with God and was having experiences with God, and it became so much more personal. And so there's always been an insecurity in me that's like, yeah, how are you supposed to say that you're a Christian if you don't know all the stories and you haven't like read as much as other people? You didn't learn this your whole life. And like at the end of the day, I think that the knowledge comes because you begin to crave it, you know, as you go through a relationship. But I think that it's okay, like the love comes first. And there's so many people that know so much about the Bible, but they don't have that personal relationship and they don't have the love. So I think that that has been was always an insecurity in mine. And then it'd be like, okay, I'm gonna do this or do that, and then people are gonna ask me about being a Christian, and then I don't know what to say because I'm not gonna have the right answers or the stories or the names or the chapters or different things. And it doesn't matter. None of that matters. Awesome. Because at the end of the day, nobody can take away my experiences. When I was growing up, when I was in LA and like really struggling, the only thing, when I was by myself, the only thing that I had was me and God, you know? And at the end of the day, like when I'm alone, that feeling that I have in those prayers that I reach for, and just like little miracle moments, even a couple that I've told you, like, I truly believe that is the voice of God, and nobody can take that away from me. You know, it's one of those things that's just completely undeniable, and not everyone has felt that, you know, and everybody has a different view of it, and that is totally fine. But this is my experience. And I think, I just feel like you're supposed to give credit where credit's due. And if you want me to be honest and tell you how I've gotten to where I've gotten, it wasn't me. It was God, and it was my relationship with Him. And a lot of people want to tell you, like, are you sure you want to say that? That's a testy subject. But it's like, maybe it is, and maybe I don't have all the answers, and maybe I don't know, but I know it's real for me.
Right.
And if you don't want me to talk about that, then that means that I'm lying.
That makes
And that means I'm holding back, and I'm not being honest.
Yeah, that makes it, that's what's true for you. It makes it worthwhile. It makes, well, from my own experience, when you give it to Him, you allow more of it to come your way because it's what you believe in. You can put your thoughts and your heart and your everything into one place.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. To me, it sounds like you're divinely guided.
Mm-hmm. I feel it. That's, I feel it so much.
That's, I mean, that's something that it's clear that, yeah. You know, you, when you focus on that and you say, hey, I let go.
Yeah.
And you let God. You, the things that start to come your way, you then accept them because you know, okay, if it's good, it's good. Thank you, God. Yeah. If it's bad, well, this is what you wanted for me. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I think however you frame it, whether you call it connected to the source or God that is written about in the Christian Bible or the Old Testament, what is apparent is that you feel, you know, a strong connection. And that, I think everybody, well, those who can relate to definitely get it. I don't call it, you know, God, for me personally, but I just think that if you feel it, you know about it.
Yeah.
That's all that matters.
That's awesome. That's all that matters.
Because who's right? You know, how many religions are there?
Right.
How many sects of
even Christianity denominations. Has like tons of denominations.
Yeah,
right?
And that's what I mean. It's like it doesn't matter how you get there. It's like movie making. Nobody ever sees everything behind the scenes. Mm. But they all believe in the end.
So does that mean you'll do like a lesbian film?
Maybe. Just kidding. I think, it just all comes down to love. And sometimes I look at it and I'm like, wow, there are all these religions and different things. And it's just like, but why? Because that just separates everyone. And I don't think that was the point. You know, I don't think that was the point at all. I think it all comes down to love.
Well, ultimately, I mean, look at Jesus. Jesus didn't step up and say, I'm going to start a religion.
Yeah.
No, he was just
kind of like, this is how I live. Like,
yeah.
This is how you
He's
live.
Doing what you're doing. He set the example for you.
Just leading by example.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that to me, right? Buddha, he was just trying to figure it out.
Yeah.
He wasn't trying to organize Buddhism.
Yeah.
You know, it was just what it was. He mm-hmm. wanted something for himself
mm-hmm.
and he felt that there was something bigger than him and he set out to find it.
I think that there are like three major aspects to a healthy person. One is a decent level of spirituality, whatever that is. Two is exercising your body. And three are the things that you put into it. So what kind of stuff are you eating? Nutrition is huge. We all know that. It affects the way we feel.
It affects the way you feel. And I honestly, like, what you put in your body, like, so many people have health issues or they're getting sick or different things. And people don't really put food and illness together, but you gotta know that like whatever you put in your body, that's the fuel for your everyday, for your life. And it's like, we'll spend so much money on cars and clothes because we want to look great and all these things, but it's like, then we're going to go to In-N-Out or we're going to talk about and get the cheapest thing that we possibly can because we're just like, food for cheap.
Or we're gonna bitch because the organic price is like 75 cents more than the conventional version.
But you think about it, if you actually spend the money in organic or whatever it is, then it may take longer, but over time, you have less hospital bills.
Mm-hmm.
And you're taking less medication and all that stuff.
Did you see Food Inc.?
No.
You need to watch that. That's
great. That's all super
sizing. Yeah, that too.
But your food is your fuel and your food is your medicine. And it should be that way. But then it gets hard because it's like things are advertised like meat and milk. And you need all this protein and this calcium and all these different things, which you do need certain things. But at the same time, like, it's just people's minds are twisted on like what's good for you and what's not good for you.
I totally agree.
I became vegetarian in high school.
Okay.
Which I'm from Augusta, Georgia, and it's all state.
Yeah, that's a crime, right? Isn't that a misdemeanor?
My dad thought I was just going through a phase. He was like, whatever, you'll get out of it one day. And I was like, no, Dad, you don't understand.
No meat whatsoever, no fish? No meat
whatsoever. I was eating fish. So I did that for a little bit, and the guy that I was dating at that time, his mom was a vegetarian her whole life, and her dad, his stepdad, he actually had a barbecue business, so it was really funny. Wow. It was really funny. But their whole family, including the guy I was dating, decided to go vegetarian and just test it out for a little bit. And I was like, oh, that's cool, but I'm not going to do that because I like eating meat. So I started hanging out with them more and more, and slowly I was just eating what they were eating, and then I'd come home and I'd have meat sometimes with my dad and my mom or whatever, but then slowly I was like, ooh.
Really?
Yeah, I just got turned off by it, and I was like, I don't really want that, and I feel fine without it. I don't think I need it. Like,
you probably have more energy.
Yeah, I had more energy. I was feeling better. So I stopped eating that. I was still eating fish. And then I ended up moving to California. And in California, being health conscious is, like, the thing.
It's mandatory, you know? Actually.
Yeah, and everyone's, like,
prerequisite to get into the state. Right. You don't cross the border.
Yeah, unless you have a fresh juice. Everyone was really aware of their bodies. And, like, you find, like, a bunch of really healthy restaurants and different things. And I got really into it. And then I tried, like, eating raw for a while. So I went that. At first, I cut out, like, dairy and all of that for a bit, and I was feeling better. I was still eating a little bit of eggs, but then slowly I cut that out too, and I was just completely vegan.
Boo eggs.
I eat the shit out of eggs, so screw you guys.
So
that's what it smells like to me.
Oh, it's terrible. So I was vegan for a while, and then I started going to acupuncture and getting, like, herbal testing, and the woman that I go to is a healer. She's amazing, and she'll literally can do muscle testing, and even now, if I were to eat one egg, I would go to her, like, in a week, and she'd be like,
been eating eggs, eh?
You've been eating eggs.
You're kidding me.
And I'll be like, how did you know? But she just knows, like, she knows what it works with my body and what doesn't. Corn is really bad for my body. Eggs, refined sugar. Wheat, okay, this is a big thing. Everyone thinks wheat flour, that's really great. Wheat is actually something that reverses the effect of healing in your body.
Wheat.
So anytime I'll go to acupuncture and have an injury, she's like, do not eat any wheat, do not eat any refined sugar. Because if you want to get better, this is only going to make it worse and make you more inflamed.
Yeah.
Wow.
So it's catalyst for inflammation. Things like that that we don't know, and we're convinced that certain things are so good for us, so that's all we eat. But really, those aren't the things that are actually that great for us at all.
Who's telling us those are good for us, by the way? Who's behind that?
Well, who's this FDA people? Who yeah. are these guys? Why is it a food and drug administration?
Bunch of rapscallions. Yeah.
Because food makes you sick. And then you take drugs. Ooh. So there's a conspiracy. I'm not saying it's true. But
he's just saying it's out there.
It says that, you know, people the people in charge of the food in our lives, quote unquote, I just did a quote with my fingers. Those are the people who are putting bad shit into our food,
yeah.
so that we then get sick to go get the drugs.
So Christian's a dedicated vegetarian, and I'm a dedicated meat eater. So take us through a day. What are you eating on a daily basis? Yeah.
Well, I'm kind of upset about this, but my.
You look so upset.
Right, I'm bummed.
My Vitamix is broken.
You have a Vitamix.
I have a Vitamix, which is an incredible blender.
Big time.
It can pulverize anything.
Mm-hmm.
It's awesome.
It can pulverize pennies. I've had a penny shake.
Ninjas are awesome, too.
I hate cleaning this sucker, though, man. Yeah. God, the cleaning stinks.
Yeah, but it's so worth it. So, normally, I would have, like, say, a smoothie for breakfast.
What's in there?
I'll put spinach in there. I'll crack a coconut, and I'll scoop out the meat in the water.
Nice.
And then I'll
put
a little bit of cacao powder and fresh mint and half an avocado.
Boom.
And blend it up with ice.
It's very Brazilian of you.
Medium
triglycerides.
What kind of almond milk, soy milk?
I didn't use any milk.
You don't use any milk?
If you
coconut juice.
Water in the meat makes its own milk. So you have, like, fresh coconut milk that you make.
Nice.
So that's, like, my favorite thing, but I haven't had that for a while, but still. So say that for breakfast. And then for lunch, say... I still eat, like, quinoa, brown rice, different things like that. So say you get, like, quinoa and you get a little bit of, like, black beans and, like, kale, kimchi, almonds. Like,
what are you getting at Whole Foods together. Or something?
I get that at Whole Foods. Or even, like, there's a lot of vegan restaurants that I found that are so delicious.
RFD.
And so good.
Do you know RFD?
Daily.
Oh, I've been there best.
Once, but not. Have you ever been to Sun Cafe?
No, where is that?
So good. That or Cafe Gratitude?
Yes, Gratitude Cafe. Jeez, wait, they changed the name.
Cafe Gratitude.
On Larchmont, yeah.
What did it used to be called?
Well, no, it used to be Gratitude Cafe. They changed. They flipped it on you.
Yeah,
now everyone's totally confused. Where am I going? Oh. How do I get there?
It's awesome.
It's so good. The I Am Whole.
I love the menu. I love the names of the menu.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Sorry, dude. We're over here.
Getting something like that, and they... I don't know. And for
you get the names of the food is like, I am grateful. Yes. I am pure.
It is.
I am bliss. Strong. I am
it's all, what do they call it? It affirms their affirmations.
But it's really funny because I've brought people there before and they'll be in the worst mood ever. And they just start laughing because they're like, how are you supposed to be in a bad mood when they're telling you are kind.
I mean, it's a scene. It is a scene. If you haven't been, that's exactly how everyone's like in this vegan cult where they cruise around and everyone's so calm and really nice.
No,
and then
dude.
And then they'll ask you at the end of the day, this is true because I went last week, they're like, do you want to hear the question of the day? Do you want to hear the question
of the day? Oh, so you did know it. You were just...
Cafe Gratitude? Yeah. No, I know it.
Oh, okay.
I went last week.
You're back in the circle, dude.
And I think the circle of trust.
What'd you get?
I had some kind of smoothie called I am
cool.
I'm like gorilla I am gorilla strong or something
Grace.
Like this. And I had
I'm
some
curious,
side dishes.
It
was
come on
coconut and almond and kale. I think it was
no.
I am strong.
Green. It was green.
Yeah. It was good.
I don't mind.
I am pure as the kale salad, which my friend had, and it looked really good.
Yeah.
And then they ask you, do you want to hear the question of the day? And I said, all right.
Of course I do.
And the question was, what inspires you? And I was like, what's the answer? She's like, no. That's the question. I was like, I know, but what's the answer? And she's like, no, I don't think you understand. And I was like, I'm just teasing. You don't have to ask me a question.
Did
Let
she
me
tell
ask you
what inspires her?
She couldn't come up with anything.
Whatever. She couldn't?
That's like not knowing the special.
I know, right?
No.
What inspires you?
What's
the number 42?
It's not what we always do? What?
I'll just always make them answer the question. Because it's really rhetorical. Like, you don't have to answer that. It's just for thinking. But I'll be like, what's yours? And I'll be like, people don't really ask me that. And then they'll tell you, and it's actually really cool. To see people's perspective on things.
Yeah, she didn't want to tell me, probably. She just didn't want to tell me. So you have something at lunch that involves
quinoa, kale,
carbohydrate
grains.
With vegetables, and then dinner is usually something similar? Or?
Something similar, yeah. I love sweet potatoes.
Me too.
So much.
It's my favorite thing ever.
Man.
Really?
I love sweet potatoes.
Yeah,
have
so
you ever?
You gotta... Oh, my God. Oh,
we're about to share sweet potato recipes.
Dude.
Tell me.
Sweet potato fries... At Ronnie's on Little Santa Monica.
I've never been to Ronnie's.
Man. Oh, they're the best thing ever.
Interesting thing about sweet potatoes, Tim Ferriss, the guy that wrote 4-Hour Work Week, 4-Hour Body, 4-Hour Chef, talked about going to that place in Okinawa where people live longer than anywhere else in the world.
Hmm.
And what he found was, among other things, this wasn't the only factor, but they don't eat a ton of rice. I heard this on Rogan's podcast. They actually eat sweet potatoes as their main carb source.
Sweet potatoes and yams.
Yeah.
They're the same thing.
Well, sweet potatoes are more yellow. Yams are really orange.
Yeah. Yams are yummy. But yams, apparently in Jamaica, the part where Usain Bolt is from, that's supposedly what makes him fast.
Really?
Seriously. He's like,
sweet potatoes are
sugar. He says to anybody who asks him, he's like, why are you so fast? Well, it's not his long ass legs. It's not his.
It's, right. It's not his
muscle.
Genetics or his muscles.
Yeah.
It's...
He loves to say that it's the yams from.
That's so funny.
It's probably not true, but that's what I remember. Did it?
That's bad news.
Well, we're still going, so we're gonna put an awesome picture of you.
Yeah, this is gonna be a still now since it just cut off.
It's done.
It just cut off. Period.
Yeah. I'm gonna try again. Let's see again.
Oh, that's poop.
We've been having so much fun that...
This is my fault, Kathryn, because
Technology
today and me, we're not friends.
Take the camera off me and put it on Kathryn for the end of our podcast. Let's just go ahead and at least have it on her for the end, no?
Sure.
The other day, I got stopped. I was traveling and I got stopped in security because I had a sweet potato.
What? For a... What?
Because I had a sweet potato in my suitcase, but... I don't know. This is just my brain. I think, like, oh, they're not going to have really anything good to eat at the hotel. So I'm just going to ask them to cook my own sweet potato. Or if I have a microwave, I'll just cook it myself. So I
wrap. Do you wrap it in
Saran wrap? Yeah.
Saran wrap. I do it in a wet napkin.
Oh.
Yeah, Ashley taught me that.
Huh.
Yeah. Well, actually, it doesn't even have to be wet. You wrap it in the napkin, and then you put it in. It ends up being wet because the microwave pulls out moisture.
How cool. I didn't know that. But I brought it, and they couldn't tell what it was, and then it was really awkward because they end up saying, I have to check your bag. And I was like, okay.
Oh, because they saw it on the thing.
They're like, I'm checking your bag. And so they end up checking my bag, and I was just like, sorry, guys, that's my sweet potato. And they were just, like, so confused. I was dying
this
laughing.
This one died, too.
Oh, my God.
I'm not joking. I'm not joking. Down. Hold on. We got one left.
Wow.
Two down.
How did that happen?
I don't know, dude. You're the tech king.
Oh, no, the tech not today. Wizard. No, seriously. I don't know if it's back on. Oh, it's back on.
No, it's off. We got her. So we should wrap this up since we've got her on camera at the very end. Kathryn, what a pleasure it's been having you. Thank you so much for coming and talking to us. I've learned a lot. I'm sure everybody else has, too.
It's a sign from God. We were going on and on and on, and we could talk forever.
He's like,
it seems like
done.
It.
He's like, that's enough. That's enough secrets. Today.
You don't understand. I, the way that I go about my day, everything's a sign.
Yeah.
Everything's a sign, and it could be a little, what would you call it?
Hokey.
Hokey, whatever. Hokey. I think it's more. I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. Mm-hmm. You know, there's no art. The highest art is no art. I'm pointing over at a poster I have in my office.
Yeah, hokey is pejorative. I don't mean that. Yeah. I mean, it's good that you see signs and everything. It means your eyes are open.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's
it's
really
just,
good.
It's just there's just a everything has a purpose. Everything is put in front of you so that you could derive meaning from it. And I think that you're a perfect example of that. And I see it in you because I see it in myself. Mm-hmm. And I live by it. And you know. Thank you. Thank
Kathryn
you for reminding
McCormick
us.
For living the dream. You do it, girl. You blow our minds. Thank you so much for coming.
Can't wait to see what else is in store for you.
Do you have any party? Where can people check out everything that you do? Do you want to plug some stuff real fast?
I have Twitter.
Okay.
Kathryn, KathrynRMCC. So that's Twitter. I have Instagram, which is Kathryn R. McCormick. Facebook, Kathryn McCormick. And website,
Kathryn-McCormick.com. Kathryn-McCormick.com. All those will flash up magically.
Yeah, we'll put those
on
up.
Our video towards awesome. The end.
Thanks for hanging out. It was awesome.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you, Kathryn. You're awesome.
Alrighty.